I received some, and this will sound basic, this will sound very fundamental, and maybe that's the point. But very good, salient, sober advice from an executive coach a long time ago, which is like, what are you building? Are you building a job? Are you building a business? Or are you building an exit? And if you sit with that question for long enough, you might actually kind of get some ahas popping off at you.
Welcome to the Web Design Business Podcast with your host, Josh Hall, helping you build a web design business that gives you freedom and a lifestyle you love.
Hello, friends. Great to have you here for another episode of the Web Design Business Podcast. I just sneezed, like big time hardcore dad sneeze. Some may got on the mic, so I'm recovering from that sneeze. So I had to re-record this intro. Anyway, so good to have you for this episode of the podcast because we have a very special guest, the CEO of Smart Passive Income, Matt Gartlin, is here with us in this episode. And my gosh, you guys, this conversation, I'm so excited to share with you something that he's been actually personally challenging me with, which is to really ask yourself and think about what you're creating in your business. Are you creating a job as a freelancer, as a solopreneur, web designer? Are you creating a real business that you're going to run and treat like a business? Or are you even potentially creating an exit? Do you have the idea that maybe you don't want to do this forever and you may want to sell this? In which case, you're going to build your business very differently if you're going to plan to sell it one day. This really gets into the idea of vision for your business. And I was going to originally call this episode like how to vision cast your web design business. But as Matt and I talked about this, it became so apparent that this is the topic we need to dive into. So we're going to dive into just that to help you cast a vision for your business, no matter where you are, what stage you are in your business, to help you decide whether you are creating a job, a business, or an exit. If you don't know Matt, again, he's the CEO of Smart Passive Income. If that brand sounds familiar, it's because it was founded by Pat Flynn. And Matt has been partnered with Pat for many years now. And why I'm extra excited to bring Matt on here is he just has an incredible skill set with vision. And what's been really interesting is I've seen Matt and Pat execute this big change in the Smart Passive Income brand with how they present their courses and their training and their resources. And I've seen them over the years create a vision for a 2 to 3 year roadmap, execute it, and like finish, like a complete a phase of their vision and move on to the next thing. It really is inspiring. So I think it's going to help you, again, no matter where you are with your business, to help you create a vision, maybe even to encourage you to just pause for a second and have a CEO day and go think about your business and really be real about what you want to create. This really helped me, and I'm excited to hear how it's going to help you too. Now, real quick before I bring Matt on, I cannot recommend enough the courses that Pat Flynn and Matt Gartlin here offer inside of SPI. They have been some of the most impactful courses for me. The ones I've been through are the Power Up Podcasting course by Pat Flynn, their email marketing course, Game Changer, and perhaps one of the most ones that's maybe the most underrated is their webinar course. I cannot recommend enough that you guys check these courses out. Even as web designers, even if you don't think that these are applicable to you, they have a suite of courses that are crucial for all entrepreneurs, even web designers. So if you're interested in their courses, we have a special link set up. You can go to joshhall.co/SPI courses, and that'll zip you over to their all access pass to see if any of their courses are a good fit for you to help you out. I've gone through many of them. I am in that community. I'm in their all access pass and I highly recommend it. Additionally, for those of you who are really serious about taking the next level to your business, they have a pro community, SPI Pro. If you're interested in that, go to joshhall.co/SPI Pro and you can fill out the application to see if that would be a good fit for you. For those of you who are really on the next level and trajectory in your business, those links will be, of course, links in the show notes for this episode at joshhall.co/310. All right, without further ado, here is Matt Gartlin, CEO of Smart Passive Income. Let's talk vision and help you decide whether you are creating and what you want to create, either a job, business, or an exit. Matt, welcome back onto the podcast, man. Round two. Pleasure to have you again. Thanks so much for taking some time to chat today.
It's the new year. Thanks, buddy, for having me back. It's a thrill.
I intentionally wanted to get you back on in this new year because, as I mentioned before we kicked off here, you being local in Columbus, Ohio as well, I count it, first of all, publicly, I want to say it's an honor to know you and to be able to chat with you often. And we had recently had a meetup and you just kind of nonchalantly just laid out the vision that you had for SPI and Smart Passive Income, and then how it kind of came to life over the past 3 years. And I was thinking about that chat we had, and I was like, gosh, there's so much gold in there that I wanted to just kind of to not only learn from, but just to help my audience out with as well, because I think there's a big difference and a challenge with casting vision for particularly web designers and entrepreneurs. And you even mentioned there's kind of a difference between vision and goals. Would you care to explain maybe how you view vision and goals and the difference?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, vision is remarkably important, but maybe to put it in contrast, yeah, let's start with actually goals. If we think about goals as the things that we want to achieve, like they're the results of our hard work. They're things that, you know, are outputs, right? If we are doing the work, if we're working with web design clients, if we're redesigning and launching our own website, if we are enhancing our sales materials or pitch decks or things, you know, that's all the work. And we do that in part to hopefully achieve, again, the outputs of goals that might be, you know, an increase in clients, an increase in revenue, an increase in a profit margin. We might also just want to optimize for time. Like we want to get more of our time back, you know, in terms of our lifestyle businesses or things that are quantifiable in nature. Like these are things that are goals, right? But hopefully, like these goals are dimensions of something bigger, right? Like they are aspects of the prism that is vision, right? So like why accomplish an increase in revenue? Why pursue that? Why also at the same time, maybe try to get more time back, you know, in your business? Why do you potentially want to, you know, especially if you're a web designer, you know, maybe move into a different form of a channel, right? In terms of customer acquisition, because maybe you've specialized really well in one niche market, and maybe now you're considering growing into a second niche market. Right? Like essentially why to all of those things, you could ask why on repeat, right? And the answer should hopefully be informed by some bigger idea, some larger purpose, right? And that's what we think about in terms of vision. What I really appreciate, and I think is underappreciated in general, my spicy opinion, when we think about vision and we talk about vision, is that when it's formulated really well and with great intention, vision informs direction. It gives you a bearing. It lets you know, I need to go this way, not this way. And is your sort of master decision-making filter on what should I be doing, right? And what should I be prioritizing in my small business, right? And what am I trying to grow up to be? So that is useful for any form of really an entrepreneur, whether you're a web designer, you're a creator, you're a coach, you're an executive consultant or something like that. Like these concepts are transmutable, right? Like they're usable in almost any business model, which is why I think they're that valuable and that powerful, right? And why I think there's even a resonance when you and I were, you know, having coffee and kind of catching up at the end of the year on this stuff. And the last thing I'll maybe say in terms of trying to define really what, you know, vision is that you should know when you get there, right? Again, with the discipline with which you put it on paper and you actually, you write it out, right? And you maybe go through some revisions as anyone should, even we still do, to really, really sharpen it into something that is clear and precise. The standard sort of benchmark or earmark is to think about 2 to 3 years. So if you're writing a vision statement as a small business owner, as an entrepreneur, you want to write that statement thinking ahead, future state, to 2 to 3 years forward, mm-hmm. right? And then you will know if you get there in 2 to 3 years. Like that should be your reality 2 or 3 years from now. It's not your reality today, but it should be your reality 2 or 3 years from now. So that's what a vision is. And then it's brought to life to kind of come full circle with the goals.
That's so well framed and well said. Yeah, I'm sure I was probably like drooling and mouth agape talking with you because I realized, oh my gosh, I've been a part of the SPI world since shortly before you started. I feel like the vision of the last 3 years, and I've seen it come full circle. And I'm like, this is amazing. But it all starts with that vision, which I've personally struggled with. I have a hard time, and I'm sure I'm not alone, in looking past about a year And maybe that's just intentionality that I haven't really thought through what that would look like. But I think for me, the waters were muddied between the difference between a goal and a vision. Is it fair to say that a vision would almost be like the mission and a goal would be the, like the roadmap that actually is the practice? Is there, or how would you, is there a way to kind of,
you're very, very close. Like that's really great thinking. A vision statement and a mission statement technically are two distinct things, but they operate at sort of the same altitude. So your mission statement would almost be something that, and a lot of larger companies, especially tech companies do this, like they put it on the wall, right? Like it's almost your tagline or your mantra statement, right? It's something that if also you craft that really, really well, it is timeless. Like it works like infinitely.
Gotcha.
Right? Like it's consistent, it's accurate, it ages well. And you can go out there and just search and Google for, you know, high profile companies. You know, you think Tesla or you think IKEA or Lego or Nike, and they, what are their mission statements? And in mentioning of Nike, I don't mean their slogan, you know, I mean, like, what is their corporate mission statement, right? So those things exist. And that's to really speak to, I would say, again, to be timeless, like it's the essence of who you are as either an entrepreneur, if it's just you, or just like your business, mm-hmm. right? So that's what a mission is. And hopefully that mission, because a mission is something that you're never going to get to. It's not a point on the horizon that you achieve in terms of a live reality. It is unattainable, okay. right? It's just sort of like, it is the energy orb that's inside you powering.
The guiding light, right? Maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which again is complementary because they're useful together, but distinct from vision, where vision is something you can achieve,
okay.
right? You can get to that lived reality. Mission statements are typically shorter. They're a sentence, right? Or a sentence fragment, right? They're really punchy. Whereas a vision statement, that might be a paragraph, right? And inside that paragraph, again, to try to give some dimensionality and shape to a vision that then like you will know when you get there, you should probably have some numbers, some metrics. Like, so maybe you are putting a revenue goal out there. Maybe you are talking about a team. If a part of your vision, and this isn't again true for everybody, but this is again the magic of like working on your vision, right? Is I want a team, I want a small team, I want to have a couple people on my team full time. If that's true for you, then that should probably maybe be written into your vision statement. And then you can put a target, you know, in terms of number of people on your team, right? As another way of doing it. If you're thinking about evolving your business in, say, brand, like rebrand, right? Or if you're evolving your business model or like how you position your business in relation to the market that you're serving, and it's going to take 2 to 3 years to get there because it's a big thing, then talk about that as well. Inside your vision statement. And that last point certainly maps, Josh, as you know, to SPI, you know, in the journey that we've been on quite a number of years now, right? In terms of our vision and mission, the mission has evolved a little bit, but I'd say like the essence of it has always kind of been there. But the vision has definitely changed, right? Because you get 2 to 3 years out, we've mostly hit those marks, you know, over time. And then you have to vision cast again. And at least in the world of SPI, coming out of last year, now that we're recording in January of 24, like we mostly hit the then current vision statement. So it was time to like reintroduce the next vision statement. So our next vision statement is for 2027. So the one that I rolled out to the team at our strat planning summit in New Orleans last year, last October, was effectively the 2027 vision for the company. Like where we will be if we maintain course mm-hmm. and we achieve what we need to achieve, we will be here by 2027.
So much gold here, Matt. I think I just had a mental breakthrough realizing that a mission is timeless. The vision is probably a 2 to 3 window. And then the goals I would imagine could be broken down quarterly, annually to make sure you're on track for the vision.
Precisely right. The goals are, think of them like really important breadcrumbs, right? They kind of lead the way, and goals can change and flow over time. Cause maybe you're in a season of your business where, you know, revenue is really important. I would say that probably revenue is always important, but maybe in this particular season, it's especially important. Maybe you're trying to build a new revenue stream, right? So you want to define that as a goal. And like you can think about also kind of just to re-reference tech startups, like frequently with tech startups that are well capitalized, if they've raised a lot of funding, they operate unprofitably with intention. Like profitability is not a goal, right? Profitability might be our goal though, or in different seasons, profitability may become more of a goal, right? So goals can ebb and flow. And again, think of them as like those really important breadcrumbs along the way.
So when it comes to casting a vision, this is what I think I don't have any true experience with this. I haven't really read enough about this or been in any programs that have helped guided me through this to this point, but I'm just wondering how far, like the 2 to 3 window makes sense to me. I even struggle looking that far though. And I can't imagine I'm uncommon with that, but I guess how would you help me or anyone who has trouble looking past about a year with what it looks like? Because I have an idea of what I want, but I don't know if it's a confidence thing or, what it looks like. I guess the question is, okay, now we're in like, you know, therapy session, Matt, why can't I look past a year if we're going to dumb this question down?
Yeah, I will do my best to play therapist, but I'm not a certified therapist.
Business therapist, of course.
Yes, precisely. More maybe executive coach a little bit, there but any which way, you're absolutely, especially not alone. It is remarkably common in not just like the creator world, but in my strong opinion, in my experience, most of the startup world in general, you know, small business. Because so many of us that are founders or co-founders starting these little companies, whether, again, they are service-based or product-based, or if they're in e-commerce, or if they are, you know, really anything, we come to that almost trying to solve our own problems as some version of a maker, right? We're trying to make the thing. You know, we're a creator, we have creative energy, we're doing the work. We don't always, and especially not usually, come from, I'd say, like a deliberate business background, right? I just happen to come from a business background, I guess, among other backgrounds. So I guess the point there is, yeah, it's just an underdeveloped muscle. So I guess to play pseudo therapist, I don't in any way analyze what you've even just said or our conversations today, Josh, as like, I don't know, you have some unprocessed, you know, source of trauma, you know, in your past that,
vision
you know, that is blocking you. Mm-hmm. I think it's reps, right? And we need more reps or to mix metaphors at bats, right? To think about baseball. And most of us that are participating in the creator economy and continuing to try to find our way online, especially, we're doing this kind of without a playbook, right? We're kind of making it up and we're listening to good people as best we can select them. And this is where, again, I'll continue to throw spicy opinion in the mix, which is so much of it for years, and it feels like it's even getting louder, is like build your audience, build your list, which these are all really important things, like to be sure, right? But it drowns out some of this conversation. It drowns out like, but what are you building, right? It's one thing to be like, yeah, you should go build an email list and get skilled in email marketing. And oh, by the way, you should also get you know, serious just about maybe copywriting, because that's really important for conversion. And maybe you can consider a podcast too, right? Those are all important things to take seriously and seriously consider doing. And if you make the choice to do that work, like, okay, yeah, do it well, and hopefully it'll generate results. But still, like, it asks the question of like, why do that, right? That's the work. That is a bottoms up approach to business, right? Let me just start doing work, see if it works, right? And maybe at some point I'll figure it out along the way. And I'm not trying to, I guess, be in any way, and I hope I'm not coming across like dismissive or putting that down. Like, it's a great way to get a lot of experience, but it is, again, incomplete.
Yeah.
It doesn't take a moment to take a breath and step out of the work and say, okay, this is all the bottoms up stuff. I should probably think top down also. I should think top down about why am I doing this? Right. Where do I want to be? Right. And then kind of also look at your business that way.
I think you're spot on, Matt. And what you're making me realize is what the path that I took coming from a musician background into just building websites, doing graphic design, to suddenly doing that for clients. And then suddenly I have a business. So I had to learn to go from being a freelancer, just hunting for work where I could, to being a business owner. And I think in a lot of ways, the years of doing that is still what I'm working through now as an entrepreneur and as a business owner, is I'm continuing to take things like vision casting, mission, and big picture stuff more seriously, where I was quite reactionary the first decade of my journey. as an entrepreneur. And I think you helped me pinpoint exactly why I struggle or have struggled with really thinking past about a year, because I tend to think about annual goals and that's about it. Like, I know what I want to make. I know what kind of lifestyle I want this year, but that's about it. But this is really framing this differently. And I think it makes a lot of sense to my audience too, who have the same path that I did primarily. You freelance, crap, you got a business. Now you're becoming a business owner. What I would love to know is, what is the difference and what are the categories between a vision and a goal? Like, I imagine with vision, like you mentioned, revenue is probably a part of that. Team may be a part of that, but I imagine those could still be goals too. So I guess I'm kind of curious, how do you see the difference between what a vision is? That's like a 2 to 3 year thing and a goal, but maybe a year.
Yeah, no, that's great. Let me start again with vision, actually. An important quality to me, and I think especially for business owners in more advanced life cycle phases of their business. So maybe not necessarily from day one, when you're freelancing, for example, right? But as you get some traction and as it's working and you're evolving, I think this quality I'm about to express takes on that much more value and significance, which is like the identity of your company, right? Identity is a really powerful and important thing to think about, to distill, to try to be very precise about with language. And when you think about describing your company, your small business, like what is the identity of that, right? If you're a web designer, do you have a web design agency? Is it a web design studio? Or is it not that? What is the identity you're choosing, for your company, not only in the current moment, right? But vision wise, 2 to 3 years forward. For SPI, we've made some really bold moves when it comes to the notion of identity. First and foremost, it's not just about Pat, right? So for folks listening that have familiarity with SPI and with Pat, he's the creator. I came into the picture a little bit later. And Pat's still a really critical piece of the puzzle. Don't get me wrong. And like, he's still kind of the face of the brand, but we're a media company. At least like that was the identity that we really chose and built more into, I'd say starting 3 years ago when Pat and I really decided to take some bigger moves, right? It wasn't just, oh, we're a creator, or we're a personal brand. Oh, it's Pat Flynn. It's like, no, there's a team, there's a larger purpose, yada, yada. And now, as I rolled out to the team last year, and we're starting to talk about it a little more publicly with that new vision statement for 2027, because we are all in on community and things, Josh, we've talked about, and I believe I've brought up on the show in the past, our bigger idea is to become much more the incubator for online small businesses. Mm-hmm. And that word choice and that identity is very deliberate. It pulls from, references and inspirations, at least to me, in terms of thinking about Techstars and Y Combinator as really remarkable organizations in the tech world, right? That are, incubators of tech companies. I think about other much larger kind of professional organizations like Vistage and EO and some, some of those sorts of models, that are, private networks for, kind of business owners and executives. And we're trying to create like a hybrid idea of that and a more approachable version of that for an underrepresented, in our opinion, swath of the market, right? Like, because when you think about Techstars and Y Combinator from the tech world and Vistage and EO and others kind of in this like higher end executive coach access kind of play, they're expensive, they're hard to get into, and we're often kept out of those things, right? I've gotten into some of those in the past, at least Vistage in EO, but we want to be able to create a version of that that's really helpful and very approachable for creators, freelancers, coaches, consultants, small business owners, solopreneurs, right? So to us, that's a really galvanizing idea. It's a bigger idea than just like, oh, we have courses, right? Oh, or it's just one person. Now, our vision is to be, the go-to incubator for online small business in the way that we define that.
Would identity be a part of the mission or separate from the mission? If you were to write out a mission statement,
I think the mission informs it. Okay. I think the mission is a big part of the energy source of the vision. So again, I think they are, or I know them to be, in the way that I have practiced them and have learned them from my past mentors, right? And executive coaches, like they are distinct things, but they work so well together, and they should very much interlock. Yeah. So yeah, and I maybe overprocessed that. Yeah. Sorry. But then again, from that vantage point and that point of contrast, goals are very outcome oriented. And the way that I coach this and teach this is to even not only have like a number, like an absolute value. I want to generate X in revenue. I only want to work so many hours per week, et cetera, et cetera. But in addition to that absolute value is to have the rate of change as a percentage. Mm. So if you track, you know, these things, and it's not overly difficult to do, at least in terms of some of the, I'd say, the fundamentals. So again, let's just take revenue. It's like, okay, you might know your gross revenue figure from last year. And maybe for this year, or you could subdivide that down to a quarterly level and you say, hey, I want to hit now this revenue number. And that represents a percent growth of Y, right? So if X is the revenue goal as an absolute value, Y is the percent growth as a, you know, rate of change, if that makes sense. And that's what a goal is. You know, a goal is something that like you hit the bullseye, you know, that's what you're shooting at with your arrow, right? And you can also put against it a percent rate of change.
Gotcha. Yeah, that makes a ton of sense too. Cause I was wondering, one of the questions I had for you was like, how do you measure a vision other than like getting to the tail end of 3 years and being like, all right, where are we at with it? Do you measure vision, annually how did you more specifically measure the vision in any way you could with SPI since mm-hmm. what, 2019 to the end of 2023 right. or so?
You measure vision, I guess, insofar as you have confidence in some version of forecasting
okay.
to the things that you care about and the things that you're defining within your vision. So if you say like, hey, you know, in 3 years, I'm going to be $1 million business, right? Because you're not $1 million business right now. But if you want to be, right, and you say, okay, so I'm going to be $1 million business. I'm going to have like 1 million as a number, as a part of my vision statement somewhere, right? It's like, okay, well, I know what my number is today. Starting point. I know where I want to be, $1 million, 2-3 years from now. I have a path and I need to maintain a path. I need to, in fact, measure rate of change. I need to measure growth rate, right? So then that's how you would measure vision. It's like, okay, once you get 6 months in, your first year in, hopefully there is growth. Is that growth path like going to get you there, right? Is it going to get you to that million in 2 to 3 years? Or are you under that, right? Or maybe you're over that. Maybe you're just killing it, right? Which would be great. So that's how I would measure like vision, right? So you're using goals and goals within different time frames, whether you're doing goal planning at a quarterly mm-hmm. level, at a biannual level, or doing it at an annual level. And these are all independent personal choices. There is no sure. like right or wrong. There's no judgment to this. These are all tools that, you know, different entrepreneurs can select and use and wield differently. But then like whatever you choose, and let's just take annual because it's maybe a little more commonplace. It's like, okay. And let's say the vision is 3 years to kind of give it a longer time horizon. Okay. Well, growth is never linear. Don't think that it's going to be, but you could use that as a swag. So it's like, okay, if I'm at $100,000 right now and I want to be at $1 million 3 years from now, I need to generate on average a growth of $300,000 per year for 3 years. Mm. That would be a linear growth rate.
Yeah.
Is it going to be that? Probably not likely. Things always go up and down, but the net average, right, up and down, if you were to like zoom out from that graph, if you plotted it, right, would be like your trajectory is good, even yeah. though it's going up and down, like in the in like month to month or whatever, like your overall trajectory is you're on target, right, to hit that $1 million larger aspiration as a part of your vision statement.
I love that idea, Matt, of like looking at the 2 to 3 year mark, because I've tended to, and again, sure, I'm not alone, I tend to look at years as standalone things. I'm like, 2019 was here, 2020 was here, which was a big year for me as a course creator. 21 was my biggest year to date. 22 was a slight drop, and 23, as I mentioned to you, and as I mentioned publicly, has been a really challenging year. But the foundation, particularly the back half of 2023, was much better. If I zoom out on this, what feels like a bit of a failure year for me personally, in full transparency of 2023, I've realized is I've started the new vision. I kind of ended the vision in 2022 for my business setup the way it was as a solopreneur. But now that I've got Web Designer Pro going and really made this its own thing with me as the leader and the driver, but it's become a community, it was a business model shift for me. It was a pivot for me that I didn't really tactfully, you know, plan the vision. I just kind of happened. I would do some things differently, but what I am excited about now, and why I'm thinking about this like zooming out approach, is while it's a bit of a painful year in the short term, I actually think as I zoom out and look at the forecast for the next couple years, this is probably the best decision I've ever made. And it was just pivoting when I really didn't clearly lay out the vision. But now that's what I'm working on. It's one reason I wanted to have this conversation live with you, is I'm literally looking at the next 2 to 3 years now, which I've never done before.
Outstanding.
Which is really exciting. You mentioned to me something about the analogy of like turning a battleship. Can you explain that, especially for somebody like myself who has a business in motion and had a big six-figure business in motion? It's not something that I could easily just turn off and switch around. And even with launching Web Designer Pro, which is really similar in a lot of ways to what you have, it's kind of a hybrid between what you've done with SPI Pro and your All Access Academy, the community of courses. Yeah. Mine's kind of the hybrid of both of those. But it was a big shift between what I had previously with just selling well and off courses. And that was pretty much it. I was living and dying off of launches. I had really good months and really bad months, but they kind of evened out. Now I have lesser waves, but I have much more stable income that is, knock on wood, going up and to the right month after month. So that my succinct question on this is like, how do you pivot something that is, you know, in my case, like a several hundred thousand dollar business that's in motion, but I need to change it or want to change it or want to cast a vision for the next few years and it being a bit different?
Yeah. I think you've almost beautifully even described almost your own or answered your own question there, which is that it's slow and messy, at least frequently. But it's also usually if someone like you is seriously contemplating this, like if it just intrinsically feels right in terms of how you want to show up and add value, to the customers and clients you have, and your own sense of the economy and the market and where the market's going, then it's worth doing. Like it's worth going through the slowness and maybe some version of the messiness to transform, right? To kind of enter that cocoon as a caterpillar and try to emerge as something very different, right? And again, that's my own lived experience, and not only with SPI, just more recently with SPI, but some of my past startups also we have done, you know, different kind of identity transformations, not just with the words, but then, you know, the underlying model as well. And all of that throws back to the battleship reference, right? You know, as a metaphor, you know, which is like, these are big boats that you can't just snap their direction and turn on a dime, right? Like they take wide arcs in the open ocean, to turn these things. And I think that is not only true, I think it's frequently maybe underappreciated in the small business kind of entrepreneur community, because, oh, it's like, it's just us, it's small, it's just me, or I have a small team. And at the end of the day, like, it's not the biggest business, right? Like, so I should be able to change that quickly. And maybe you can, but I think even in a way that you just described it, like, and maybe I'll just speak to my own experience and not try to guess too much, Josh, to yours, but like, you don't want to just like, I don't know, fire all your clients overnight, right? Right. Like there's a certain perhaps sense of obligation or duty or responsibility to how you're showing up right now in serving and thinking about, how do I sunset that? Right. How do I give people notice? How do I try to wind things down? Right. How do I do that in a way that I can feel good about in terms of my service levels, right, to my clients? But ultimately, I'm living out and beginning to live into the transformation, right? Right. The vision, the new vision that I want to pursue. And that right there is the turning of the ship, right? It's not you're snapping it overnight, but you're trying to create an arc, right? You're trying to create an arc to what you're doing. To mix metaphors, and without hopefully confusing people or making it messy, you can think of it as the bridges analogy. Like you have a bridge right now, right? Going over something. And it's an old bridge. It's a bridge you don't want, right? You want to build a new bridge, right? But you can't just blow up the current bridge before the new bridge is done, right? So you have to keep operating and maybe throttle down over time, right? Like traffic flow, if you will, to keep with the metaphor.
By the way, I know why this current bridge came to mind, because there's so much dang construction in Columbus. I feel you there. Well, so yes, we're seeing it before our own eyes.
Yeah. But you got to build up the new one. And then at some point that old bridge comes down.
Yeah.
Right. At some point. So like for us, and I know so many others, especially in the online education, professional education space that, you know, did just like live through the golden age as we did of, you know, DIY course sales, right? Which in my opinion of the market, and I know others do as well, like we're past that golden age. Like, you know, online course sales, DIY course sales are never going to go to zero. But especially if you're entering the market and you're more of a beginner, you're more kind of at the ground level. Like it's increasingly hard to make that like your key thing, mm-hmm. right? So anyway, like we had to intentionally cannibalize that revenue stream, which was a deliberate choice we made, which is a hard choice to make, like to take our primary revenue stream and crater it, right? And somehow do that responsibly so that like, you know, you don't end up without a business, yeah. right? While then you're trying to build up a new revenue stream that you want, right? And try to throttle that so that, again, you remain cash flow neutral, or at least, you know, you maintain operating capital and, you know, you're not trying to upset a lot of clients or customers over here and you have to re-educate them on a whole new product experience. Mm-hmm. At least that was true for us, right? Like there's so much going on.
I'm going through that right now. Yeah, absolutely.
Right. So yeah, that's why this stuff is difficult. It takes more, I'd say like practice skill, it takes more reps, takes more critical kind of top down executive business thinking, you know, to design, to plan out, than just kind of like, again, rushing into it from a bottoms up standpoint yeah. and just doing work and trying to have it all produce something that, you know, is intentional.
This is so great too, Matt, because I feel like what's more common, particularly for my audience of web designers, is the first few years are messy. We're just trying to make enough to pay our bills and become a freelancer. We realize we have a business, and then suddenly then the goals and the vision and the mission and the forecasting comes into play. Even more so in the new year right now with everyone here in this episode, now is the time to really look at that vision over the next 2 to 3 years and what that looks like. But it brings us to a really interesting point that we're at right now, which is that most of my audience already have some web design clients, and I've helped a lot of members of my pro community shift this to where they're like, yeah, I don't want to do graphic design anymore. I just want to do websites, which was my story. And I learned that term that you just said a little bit ago, sunset. I think it's a really important term to focus on here because you, like you said, you need to be very tactful with how you change your offers and your models, not to piss off your current clients, not to blow up your revenue streams if you don't have something stable behind it. And I think that term sunset is something that is probably not as talked about in the entrepreneurial world. Which kind of makes me think about making like a playbook on it for my pro members. Cause I've learned a lot about that, which was to like ease down services, make some small shifts, or maybe reserve those old services for your best clients, but just not promote it or publicly do it. And then start to change the narrative about how you help with copy messaging on your website. That's kind of how I sunsetted. Well, anyway, that's kind of what I did with my web design business. I went from being a graphic designer to doing websites and then phasing out my graphic design, which is really common. But that gets into the vision, because if you don't have a vision for how to do that, what that looks like. And I imagine you could even set goals and benchmarks on like, okay, if I do graphic design for 3 more months, but every month I chip away this and this and this, I guess that's how you could probably measure sunsetting, right? Like by the end of the year, I want to have this completely off my plate kind of thing.
Yeah, you can define goals, and you can use goals to then illustrate a reverse growth rate, like a decline, right? Where it's like I currently have 20 clients, right? And you don't want that anymore. In the way that even Josh, you're articulating beautifully, like you want to sunset, dial down that side of your business while you're growing maybe a membership community, while you're trying to do small group stuff, you're trying to maybe create web design templates, right? And you're trying to sell them like those useful templates. And I have a buddy in the web design space that does that. So anyways, so with clients, it's maybe I want to be at 20, or I am at 20, I should say right now, and I want to be at 5 at the end of the year, right? That can be a goal, right? And then when you put goals next to each other, if you, again, design this with great intention, maybe the master idea is I want to keep my revenue neutral. So you can have your revenue, whatever it is today, your goal at the end of the year is the exact same freaking number, right? It is flat, right? But then, and by itself, you're like, well, okay, whatever. But if you then stack other intentions goals to say, look, my revenue is flat, but I'm going to have a 75% decrease to the amount of clients I have going from 20 to 5, right? And I'm going to have X amount of community members from maybe zero, because you don't have that today. If this is the choice you make, you're making that choice for your business, right? And then that's going to create this new revenue, right? Like, that's how you can start to stack these goals together. And that kind of tells the story. It tells the story of sunsetting this, bringing this new one up, and trying to keep revenue flat at the same time.
Yeah, I love that visualization and that approach, man. I've honestly never thought about that with the idea of setting goals to like reduce a wing of a service intentionally in order for the next best thing to come. I mean, what we're really getting into is like killing off something that's good to birth something that's great, or to create something that's great. That's kind of how I'm looking at this.
Yeah, the most perhaps iconic example of this ever is Apple and what they did with the iPod, right? If you're old enough like me to have like lived through that, you know, the iPod was revolutionary, oh, yeah. Right? Of course it was. It was a remarkable invention.
Yeah, now kids are like, what? You have to like move your thumb in a circle? What?
Yeah, I mean, unless you're going like, I don't know, eBay or some third party market to like get them. I don't even know where you would get them. Like Apple doesn't sell. I don't think they sell.
I didn't even think about that. Yeah, they don't sell those anymore. Right now.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe they have like one.
Wow, I didn't even think about that. They literally don't even sell them. It's just the phone, right? Yeah,
well, so they took their, I believe at one moment it was their flagship product. Mm-hmm. It was the thing that was their wedge that drove revenue like the craziest. It was their thing, yeah. Right? That was super mass market.
It's why podcasts are called podcasts and not radio casts or something else. Yeah.
But they cannibalized it intentionally because of iPhone, right? So like basically the iPhone is an iPod that has a phone in it, right? And now a whole lot more, but that was kind of their product evolution, right? So they brought down iPod, they cratered it as they had other brand new, more exciting things coming.
Yeah, that's so interesting, man. Again, I've been really thinking about that as my business model has shifted a bit in what is Web Designer Pro, which in my humble opinion is great. What I had previous to this was good, but I realized I also found pain points with my students, and I saw what was working really well. In my case, it was the students who had all my courses and were also getting coaching with me. Those were the ones who were getting the best results. And that's what I decided. I need to make something that has all of this. And if somebody's going to go through it, they got to go through all of it to get the results. That's how I came up with Web Designer Pro. I say that, and I share that examples to say, for any web designers looking at your clients, look at what like results, like the best results you get for clients, and then make an offer around that. Did that factor in with SPI, with how, you know, you and Pat were looking at students of the DIY courses? Did you find commonalities between students who maybe had more resources that were getting better results? Or I'm just wondering if you were able to measure any student results that help you come up with Pro and then now the Academy with the all access to courses.
Absolutely. It was a key input. Not the only one, but a very clear and to some degree measurable one.
Yeah.
So you can I would hope at least every major kind of LMS platform worth its salt, the Kajabis, ThinkFX, Teachables of the world, and we use Teachable, you can measure, the system will tell you completion rates, right, of your students going through courses. It is an imperfect metric, I will say that, but it is a barometer, right? And traditionally, like not just us, but just like in the wider market, right, of isolated learning, DIY course learning, completion rates are pretty low. That's kind of the general idea. But when you move more into interactive learning, when you move more into cohort-based environments or community-powered environments, you see exponential improvement in terms of completion rates.
Yeah.
And again, it doesn't tell the whole story, that one metric, but it begins to tell the story. It begins to give the signal, like the direction, right, to some of these, now we believe, truths, right, yeah. Empirically, you know, with other things in terms of lifetime value, right? Like how do you measure lifetime value as a real economic, you know, indicator from, you know, DIY course sales? And then how do you measure lifetime value from say someone now that is a community member where we have courses and we're designing pathways through our curriculum and we're hosting our accelerators, which is what we call, you know, our cohorts. And now we can measure LTV in a very different way. And it's a much more exciting number for us, right? So yeah, absolutely. When we think about retention, we think about quality of experience. When we think about outcomes, right, for our students, the results that they're getting, which is what you're talking about, you know, the model that we have and that others are certainly moving into as well, like we're doing it, I think, with not only the right, I'd say, like business motivations, right, to run a healthy, vibrant, profitable company, but also the right customer motivations, right, to give them a better quality experience. And potentially, as a very loose parallel, I guess I could think back and harken back to that iPod, you know, example, yeah, where it's like the iPhone experience is superior, right, to the iPod, even though the iPod was in its heyday like the best thing, but there's just a better thing now.
Gosh, I hope everyone takes that to heart with their own web design customers. Like, look at what's working, make the pivots and changes accordingly to keep on getting better results. Because at the end of the day, what I've realized is if you focus on what gets people better results, it just makes everything stronger. You get more confident with your packaging and your offers and your rates, with how you sell. Mm-hmm. Like, it's a lot easier to sell something when you know a lot of people have gone through this and they've got really good results. Suddenly there's just a framework and a foundation of confidence that you never really have, especially as web designers, when you're like, I made you a nice site, but I hope it works. Whereas you can really start to track and measure those results from web design clients in particular. I just want to encourage everyone to really think about that this year in 2024. Matt, as we get ready to close this conversation, I know we need to roll here soon. I did want to ask one thing real quick about vision. And it brings me back to when I first started my business. I had a friend from high school who, shocker, was not a business owner. He was an employee, but he was like, oh, so what's your 5-year plan? And I was like, no idea. I could only look a month out back then, let alone a year. So to that, I say to you, like, what's your thoughts on people who have that mindset of like a 5-year plan, a 10-year plan? Or do you feel like 2 to 3 years is about the max that's realistic or at least, you know, attainable for vision?
Yeah, no, it's a great question. I feel this a good bit of the time when I teach strat planning as like a formal business discipline. This territory is where we start to kind of get more into the art side of this than say the science. You know, what's the difference between a 3-year vision and a 5-year vision? Not much, honestly. Like yes, it's 2 years, and yes, you can accomplish a lot in 2 years. That's hopefully, you know, obvious. But when we think about like the practical utility of doing that as a business exercise, especially in small business, right, where, you know, resources are limited, we're not, you know, a corporate Goliath, right, where like you really need to be like really dialed in to probably, you know, 4, 5, 6 year plans if you have physical inventory and your supply chains are crazy long and complicated, right? Like that's a whole other thing, right, in terms of probably the practical utility of like a 5-year plan being different than a 3-year plan. But I think for our purposes as small business owners, there's not as much variability, right, in terms of, again, the practical value of sitting down, especially if you've never done this before. Like if this is the first time you're even considering this and hopefully getting excited by this, yeah, of like sitting down and doing this, like what's the difference between doing a 3-year version versus a 5-year version? Frankly, very little, right? Because it's new, the reps aren't there, and our businesses are not so sophisticated for some of the reasons I just mentioned that, yeah, like it's going to make the biggest difference in the world. So I guess that's a more qualitative than quantitative answer or thought.
It feels man. 5 years feels different than 3.
Right. It feels different, right? It's a qualitative thing. It's like I have a better grasp just mentally. I can almost like get my hands around 2 years. Like I can kind of get a sense of that. Right. But 5 years, like I can't get my hands around that idea as well. Yeah. So is it worth my time to try? Is it worth my time, my team's time to try to get our hands around a 5-year vision? Right. Maybe. But especially if it's just you, especially if you're earlier in this kind of practice for your business. Yeah. I would say stick to the shorter end, honestly.
Yeah. I think that's great advice, man. Well, I have one final question for you, Matt. Before I get to that, though, where would you like everyone to go to check you out. I have an affiliate link with SPI that I'll put in the show notes, but what would you prefer folks go to? Do you want them to check out the podcast or were you, where would you like people to go?
As you know, and as I have perhaps said on the show in the past, is like, I like being sort of like a silent secret weapon. So like, I'm not a big, you know, Twitter X guy or any of the social stuff. You can find me on LinkedIn. If I do anything at all, it's on LinkedIn. You can just search for Matt Gartland for LinkedIn. And then, yeah, you know, SPI, to what even degree, like strat planning and business development, just all of these sorts of things potentially excite you. You know, I talk about that a lot. I have a course. I run an accelerator around strat planning for entrepreneurs and small business owners inside our pro community specifically that, you know, Josh, you have a referral for. So yeah, like check that out if that sounds appealing to you.
Heck yeah, man. I'll make sure we link that all in the show notes. And I've actually dubbed you the Batman of entrepreneurship just because you do a lot of awesome work, but it's usually in the shadows. Not always forward facing.
Huge Batman fan.
But I'm still going to try to convince you to write a book one day because I want to read the heck out of that thing.
That I want to do. Yeah. The get famous online, have a million Twitter followers. That's not my thing, I do want to write a book. Yeah. I do want to write a book.
Okay. Well, hopefully maybe that'll be after the next 3 years, maybe that'll be the next vision. Real quick, Matt, for those who are really pumped up about this, what would be like, but they're still like, okay, I'm going to write my vision statement today. What would like a 101 basic vision statement include? And then we'll help off here.
I received some, and this will sound basic. This will sound very fundamental and maybe that's the point. But very good, salient, sober advice from an executive coach a long time ago, which is like, what are you building? Are you building a job? Are you building a business? Or are you building an exit? And if you sit with that question for long enough, you might actually kind of get some ahas popping off at you.
Ooh, that's good.
Because when we enter, or at least when so many of us do, not to paint hopefully with too broad a brush, but if you endeavor to create your own thing, one of the greatest, most awesome choices and pursuits, I think, of, you know, sort of even the human experience, not to get too philosophical about it. And there's no wrong answer here. Let me quickly and very emphatically emphasize that next. There's no wrong answer. But just with intention, if you want to build a really great job, fantastic, do that, right? You know, replace your 9-to-5 or just, you know, create a really great job that supports your family, right? Like that would be amazing if that's true, if that's what you want. And quite frankly, even with the entrepreneurial journey, a lot of people start there, right? At the freelancing level. I even have that tour duty as well under my belt, right? But potentially over time, you know, at a different season of your business, you may realize, I've built a really great job, but now my aspirations have changed. They've evolved. And I have a great job and I'm grateful for this job that I've created for myself. But I think I want to climb a slightly bigger mountain. I think I want a business now, right? And it's a very different thought. It's a very different way to then kind of, it would flip back on everything we've even talked about over the last hour around top-down thinking, vision statements, different sets of goals, right? How you're defining those goals, how you identify yourself in your own head. You're not just an entrepreneur. You're now an executive. You're now a CEO, right? You got to think and act differently. Should you enter that headspace, right? Should that be something you go after? And all of that is even very different than like if you're building an exit. Now, not many of us do that. Like exiting is hard. Building something that sells is not easy. And it's not for everybody. Mm-hmm. So I'm not trying to sell, like say like, oh, it must be that outcome.
Right.
I've had a couple, like that's, I guess, exciting to say, but also it's been torturous. Some of them, like it's been hard. So that question, yeah, what are you building? And that doesn't have to be like for the rest of your career, right? It could just be contextualized to what am I building in the next year? What am I building in the next 3 years? Am I just building a really great job that supports my family in the next 2 to 3 years? Fantastic answer. But if it's like, if you sit with it long enough, if you talk to your significant other, you talk to some trusted friends, and you're like, dude, maybe you should push yourself a little bit more, or maybe that idea just kind of creeps in on its own. It's like, you know what? I think I want a business, right? That's great too. But then it really informs then subsequent questions, right?
Yeah.
To everything we've talked about today.
That is some gold advice there, ladies and gentlemen. Matt, thank you so much for this again. And we'll have to make round three maybe about exit strategy, because that's a whole nother conversation.
I have some humdinger stories for that.
We'll really dig into the painful Matt passed on that one then. But that's fascinating, man. What gold advice. Dude, thank you for your time. This has been fascinating for me and I'm sure hundreds of others. So thanks again for coming on, man.
Yeah. Love it, man. Thanks for having me.
Cheers, Matt. Is he good or is he good? That idea of job, business, or exit, I don't know. I hope it resonated with you just like it did me. It's really, since having this conversation, it has really made me be more intentional about how I'm thinking about my business and really setting a vision for the next 2 to 3 years. Not that things are going to be, set in stone, but it is good to just take time to think about your business, and I hope it helps you as well. Again, I cannot recommend Pat and Matt's courses with SPI enough. I have been through the podcasting course, the webinar course, the affiliate marketing course, several, and you can get access to those as well if you are interested in taking your web design business to a level where you're creating more content and building your business in any ways that they can help you. Maybe doing webinars and workshops for clients. You can use that course, and you can get access to all of their courses by joining the All Access community, which I'm a part of. You can go to my link, joshhall.co/SPI courses, to get access there. And again, for those of you who want direct access to Matt in the premium community that SPI offers, you can go to joshhall.co/SPI pro for that one. Any questions, let me know. Otherwise, all the resources, links, and everything mentioned here are going to be at the show notes for this episode, which you can find at joshhall.co/310. And my friends, I would love to hear from you. If you have any takeaways from this episode, just leave it there as a comment. If you would, go to joshhall.co/310. Leave a comment. I read all the podcast comments. I try to get back to each and every one. So I would love to hear if there was a takeaway here that challenged you. And I'll even give you some resources and some coaching advice in the comments there. I'm really trying to do that more and more. So zip me a comment. You might just get some free coaching. Sound good? All right. See you over there at joshhall.co/310. And I'll see you on the next episode. Make sure you subscribe so you get the next one. Cheers, friends.